Bonsoir. Bonsoir, mesdames et messieurs. Et bienvenue à Lifelines. Ce soir, nous avons des chansons d'Eurovision des années passées à partir du commencement de participation de l'Irlande. Boy, oh boy, that took some doing. What it's all about is this. Next Saturday night, the Eurovision Song Contest takes place at the Point Theatre in Dublin. And tonight, we're going to have a look back at times past, a kind of a Proustian à la recherche du temps perdu. To start the ball rolling, let's have a look at what happened last year. Well, Charlie, that's nearly better than Leitrim winning an All-Ireland, isn't it?
not a half as good, no. If Leitrim won the All-Ireland and telling the whole country would sort of take about a week off and forget Eurovision forever.
That was a great...
Fantastic. Yeah, and Pearl, I see Cynthia there in the audience. I gave her such a swing there that people thought she was going to land in the middle of the audience after.
It was an almighty night for you, wasn't it?
Great fun. Yeah. Great fun, wasn't it, Paul?
But somebody said about this pair, you know, the Eurovision Song Contest has been won by two old geezers with beards. Is that right?
There's some truth in that. There was actually, while we were away in Malta, I think it was, recently, we were, we weren't actually judging, but we were guesting at their national song contest. And we met a guy, I can't remember his name offhand, but he was working with Granada Television, and he has a sister living in Ireland. And he was following, he's a big Eurovision fan, and he says, I follow this all the time. And he says, around the national, I always get in touch with my sister. And he phoned her up and kind of was trying to say, any idea who won or how's it going? And she just said, I was two old geezers with beards or whatever. So instantly I had to shave.
What did it do for you, Charlie? What did it do for you?
It did fantastic things for us, mainly in my home county of Leitrim, where I've made my home for the last 23 years. And a funny thing happened. About 3 or 4 days just after Eurovision, I got this big envelope in the post, big padded envelope, and I took it out, and inside was a video. And the postmark was Wales, and to this day, I don't know who sent this video to me, but I put it on, And it was a video of the very first time I was ever on television, and you'll never believe what the program was. Trum agus Eitrum.
Ah, for God's sake. Oh,
that's true.
Oh, that's strange.
That snowy week is spent.
That was the night of the snow in Drumshambo.
Exactly, yeah.
Glory be to God. All right, Paul Hankton, Charlie McGettigan. A lot of business to do tonight.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
That's absolutely. I suppose all of us really were thrilled out of our minds, were we not, by the River Dance. And what a wonderful event that was. And there is one of the two brilliant dancers, Jean Taffoyle.
Hello, Liam.
It's wonderful. She's from Gan. Come on, give her a ball of applause. Why do you seem to remember about Ballyhonus?
Gran is from Ballyhonus. My Irish side of the family is all from Ballyhonus, and she was watching on the night, and she's watching tonight. Hi, Grandma.
That's lovely, isn't it? Is your mother's Irish, of course? She's
yes, Ballyhonus. She's from Ballyhonus as well.
And father American?
My father's American.
Yeah, well, we were all very proud of your love.
Thank
did you
very
ever
much.
Win any competitions in Ireland?
I did, a few.
Yeah.
I don't want to talk about it too much. It was a while ago.
Yeah. Dancing is very disciplined, though, in the US, isn't it?
It is. I mean, it's huge in the States. Yeah. It's just, there's so many Irish in America, and it actually gives, you know, growing up, it actually gave me a huge identity
sure.
in high school. It was very important to all of us.
Jane Butler. The presenters, they came out of heaven.
Sherry
and Cynthia. What was it like, Jerry? It was a great experience for you. The high point of your career, wasn't
it? It's a cliche, but it was the high point. I think it was also one of the most amusing times as well, because after we had made our original appearance on Kenny Live, of course, Pat's with us here, I think that Cynthia thought the hind legs off me. I think the rest of the world thought that we weren't going to get on, and I think that was one of the most delightful parts, was that we actually became very firm and good friends.
It's a funny old relationship, that, you know. I mean,
I beg your pardon?
You've got to appear to be sort of playing very much as a duet, really.
Well, I think every team of every duo are always told, if you don't look like there's something dangerous going on backstage by the time you actually get on stage, you don't have the chemistry. We did our best.
You trusted Cynthia, at least you were able to trust the technology and not come flying on. Like.
That's right. Yeah, I suppose it is a high point in a way, but it's a high point apart in your career. You can't really compare it to much else that you've done or you will do, because it is the biggest, or certainly one of the biggest live shows on earth to present. And for me, it certainly was a great yardstick by which I could measure strengths and good points and bad points and so forth. And it's something that you can say, well, at least I was able to get up and stand in front of X hundreds of millions of viewers, and I was able to do that.
Are you thinking of that, Cynthia?
To be honest with you, Liam, it didn't actually strike me until the rehearsal that afternoon, on the Saturday afternoon, before the actual night, and when I was talking to this gentleman, I think his name was Sverre from Norway, and I suddenly thought, my goodness, it is really a Sverre, whatever his Christian name was. It's really Mr. Sverre. He is from Norway, and there are millions of people all around Europe, indeed the world, looking at this.
Well,
so it does hit you.
The pair of you now, I want to tell you now, I'm sure you know it anyway, you did us proud.
Thank you.
Jerry Ryan. Speaking for myself now, I have to say, I wouldn't always have chosen the songs that won the Eurovision Song Contest, but I did genuinely think last year's winner, Brendan Graham's Rock and Roll Kids, was a lovely little melody, and it had a nice nostalgic touch to it. On the night that's in it, I think we ought to hear it again.
I was 16 and so were you, and we lived next door on the avenue. Jerry Lee was big and Elvis too, blue jeans and blue suede shoes, and we never knew what life held in store. We just wanted to rock and roll, forevermore. We were the rock and roll kids, and rock and roll was all we did. And listening to those songs on the radio, I was yours and you were mine. That was once upon a time. Now we never seem to rock and roll anymore. Now Johnny's in love with the girl next door. Mary's down at the record store. They don't wanna be around us no more. Golden oldies, but we hardly speak. Too busy running to a different beat. Hard to understand. We were once like them. How I wish we could find those rock and roll days again. We were the rock and roll kids. Rock and roll is all we did. Listening to those songs on the radio. I was yours and you were mine. That was once upon a time. Now we never seem to rock and roll anymore. I was yours and you were mine. That was once upon a time. Now we never seem to rock and roll. We just never seem to rock and roll.
Paul Harrington and Charlie McGettigan with last year's Eurovision winner, Brendan Graham's Rock and Roll Kids. Here now is another little excursion into nostalgia. This time it's London and it's 1968. The singer is Pat McGeehan from Clonus in County Mona.
Norge till Irland. For en chans I livet, chance of a lifetime. Noel Killahan tar hand om orkestern. Och Pat McGeehan heter artisten. Väletablerad här och på Irland. 26 år. Jackan är så grön som den ska vara. Och polokragen är gul. Chance of a lifetime.
Pats McGeegan. And the year was 1968, the late Pats McGeegan. But we have a son here with us, a man who in his time did indeed bring a world title to Ireland, Barry McGuigan. Fáilte mór fiú sir. I suppose that's very nostalgic for you to look
indeed,
at.
Indeed, it's the first time I've seen it since I was 7 years old, so I remember it well. It was tremendous times.
How old were you, Barry,
7 years old. I remember
what was the atmosphere like?
Well, I remember when he won the national contest, Liam, we ran out the road to meet him, and of course we didn't know what road he was coming in. And the town was going into a frenzy. And it was a bonfire.
Barry, I have to say it to you, like, are there that many roads into Clonus?
There are actually five that go to the diamond where we came from. And, yeah. And there was a bonfire on the diamond. It was fantastic. I'll never forget it. And, of course, that green jacket, I've kept that green jacket. I kept it until we burned the house. Unfortunately, the night I won the world title, my mother lit a holy candle, put it on top of the TV, and it burned the bloody house down.
Wasn't there something, Barry, about an uncle that cracked his head off the roof or something?
Yeah, I'll never forget when they were adding up the points in the national contest in particular. We were allowed to stay up late, and my uncle Paddy, who is 6'1", he was in the sitting room, and it was pretty low ceiling, and he jumped up and he almost knocked himself unconscious. Well, he did actually knock himself out, and we got him round. We threw a couple of pints on him. We got him round. But it was a tremendous time, a great time for Clonus too.
Twas. You brought great honour and glory to Clonus and to Ireland. Sorry, that's Sandra beside him.
That's my wife, Sandra. Welcome both.
Now, which of us now doesn't remember this one? It's from 25 years ago, and it was Amsterdam, when an 18-year-old from Derry sang her way into the hearts and minds of Ireland, and at a time maybe where there wasn't all that much to be proud of in this country. It made us all mighty proud to be Irish.
And now, the moment we've all been waiting for. Dana, the little girl from Ireland on whom all our hopes are pinned. What can I say about Dana? You know everything already, so let's just watch the film. And here she is, wearing a fine white Bornean dress with a Celtic design on the skirt and repeated on the top.
Snowdrops and daffodils, butterflies and bees, sailboats and fishermen, things of the sea. Wishing bells, wedding bells, early morning dew. All kinds of everything remind me of you.
Ireland has won by 32 points to Great Britain with 26 points, and third, I think, Germany with 12 points. Our own Dana has won the Eurovision Song Contest. Oh, this is wonderful. When I heard I was going to Amsterdam, I thought it would be too good to be true that I should be here when Ireland would win, and it really has happened. And Derry Lindsay and Jackie Smith, they're absolutely thrilled, I'm sure, congratulating Dana. This is certainly a great night for the Irish.
And there you are. And there she is, 25 years on. You were 18, were you?
Yes, but I'm willing to lie about that.
By a little bit. Yeah. It's a marvellous thrill for you.
It really was, yes. In fact, I met Derry, came up to Derry, in fact, for a civic reception about a month ago, and I hadn't seen him since just after Eurovision time, and it was wonderful to see him again. And to remember, of course, that you're part of a team in the Eurovision, you know, it's the singer, the song and the singer together. So it was great that Derry Lindsay was able to come up. And of course, we remember Jackie Smith, who unfortunately has passed away.
Somebody did something nice too. I think it was Mary Hopkins, was it?
Yes, I was a big Mary Hopkins fan. You know, I used to watch Top of the Pops, and to be standing beside her was unbelievable to me, and she looked so beautiful, you know, her long blonde hair and her beautiful black dress. And afterwards, she was so sweet to me. She gave me a box of chocolates and a little book with a little congratulations note in it, and I thought it was so lovely of her.
Mm. But I mean, it was a stunning thing for a little 18-year-old to go and win a world contest.
Well, I was fascinated by everything because I really felt that I had slipped in there and that somebody would take me by the scruff of the neck and throw me out. So I was watching everybody and I was fascinated by everything. And I remember Julio Iglesias, I didn't know who he was, but he was very handsome in a suit and a cape. And he was practicing his scales going up and down the back of the hall. And I was very embarrassed by this because I'd never seen anybody do this. And as he'd get to the end of the hall, he would swing around and the cloak would swing out after him. And I remember thinking, somebody's going to come and take that man away in a white van.
You got a pound. Somebody told me you got a pound.
A week, yeah. Yes, at the time. But it wasn't all pocket money. It had to cover my school bus fares.
For God's sake. So look, 25 years ago in Derry, you're back twice a year, I think, you come back.
Yes.
Has the peace thing done anything for Derry?
Oh, absolutely. The city, of course, always kept its spirit through the worst of times. But it's like a veil has been lifted off. And to be able to see people stand on the street corner and talk and chat and laugh and walk at ease around the streets and the shops is so beautiful. And it's almost as though the troubles were like a hiccup that have gone, they're past, and as though they never happened. And it's so beautiful to be in the city.
That's it. And a kind of over there. Just joy. Well, now, some of us remember what she sounded like way back there in 1970. Here's what she sounds like now, 25 years on in 1995. Walter Asch, Egon Lifeline Show. Nu vill jag med kaint få en komortus, Auram, Eurofische, Harna Blienta. Look back at the Eurovision over the years. All kinds of everything won the contest in 1970, so it fell to us in Ireland to host it the following year. Now, I remember this occasion very well. It was going to be a pretty intimidating enterprise. We'd have the whole world looking in, whole of Europe anyway. Who was going to do it? Who was going to present it first? That was a big question at the time. And unlikely as it may seem, I was partly responsible for the answer to that, because the lady chosen had started a television life by presenting an Irish language teaching programme called Buntus Cainte for me. Do you remember? People should understand this. I find it hard to talk English with you because of the old experience and so on and so forth. Did the Bunters help you at that time? Do you remember?
Of course I remember, but do you mean did it help me with Eurovision?
Yeah.
Well, yes, it did, because it was experience, so yeah. I was not so intimidated by the cameras and the whole occasion.
But there was no autocue or anything in those years?
There wasn't, no. The camera was on the other side of the auditorium in the Gaiety.
And what do you do? Sort of memorise the whole thing?
Yes, yes. Yeah.
Autocue means you read it, you know.
Yes.
People think the fellas like me are clever. By the way, they have another, we should tell everybody, they have another name, they're known as Idiot Boards. It was a great experience for you.
It was, Liam, but yeah. I have to say, at this remove, it feels like another incarnation.
Yes, you left because, all that life.
Yes, well, I've spent more time out of the country than I have in it.
You're all over the world, aren't you?
Yes, my husband's a diplomat, so we've lived in quite a few places, New York, Saudi Arabia.
Somebody told me you were a sculptress.
I am, yes. That's been a late vocation.
Yeah, and you didn't bring in any of your work to show this year?
Well, there is some stuff on show in the RHA exhibition, which is on at the moment, okay. In the Gallagher Gallery.
Okay. Bernadette Ní Gallagher. The Eurovision Song Contest in the year Bernadette presented it came from the Gaiety in Dublin. Now, that was some achievement, getting it to the Gaiety. And the man behind that was Fred O'Donovan. How did you swing it?
Well, I didn't quite swing it. It was the 100th anniversary of the Gaiety, so it was my job to see that people knew the Gaiety was 100 years old. And I happened to be reading a magazine, a theatrical magazine, and there was a beautiful coloured picture of the Leeds Palace of Varieties. And it looked very like the Gaiety. So I tore out the page, and I sent it to the Director General, and I said, this is where you should have the Eurovision. And he thought it was the Gaiety.
Oh, that's lovely. God, you're some con man, Fred. That's what you are. I'm trying to remember who the Director General was at the time.
No, please. No, I'm not going to tell you. I don't want his name mentioned. It was the whole team came down,
great
including
thing, though,
Tom Grad. Like, everybody came down and looked.
Yeah, it was a great scene. I remember it very well. Yeah. That was a marvellous scene. But you subsequently became chairman of RTE, so you did. I hope you reprimanded the Director General for doing things like that.
From then on, we inspected the photographs closely.
Besides, there is Pat McGrath. Tom McGrath was a great man around this house. He was a producer, and he was the great name associated with the Eurovision Song Contest. Any memories of that night, Pat?
Oh, yes. Actually, looking at that now brought back quite a lot. Particularly that scene with the coach, you know. Tom is particularly proud of that, you know, coming in. But I have memories of it, of course, and, it was a great occasion in our home because there was excitement building up all through the week, and we were all terribly excited. Yeah. But Tom was fairly calm and cool, you know.
And somebody told me that while the thing, the thing was at its height, he was over in a restaurant eating oysters or something. Yes. Is that right?
He was. I don't know whether that was his way of, you know, quelling his nerves. Maybe it was, I don't know. But certainly to other people, he appeared extremely calm.
Many of us remember him here in the box running a big show. And he really was all ease. God rest Tom. He really was all ease in the box. There's Martin Jones, is it, beside you? This fella is an expert in the Eurovision Song Contest. You've seen them all, haven't you?
Yes, I have.
You can't have seen them all, no. Come on.
I have. I've seen them all.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah. You spent £1,000 once going off to Malmo, did you?
That's right. You had to see Linda Martin win.
God's sake.
I knew she was going to win when she won the National Song Contest.
This is a desperate question to ask on a night like this with them all around. Who was the best ever? Who was the...
Oh, God. I have to say, I'm very pleased to actually finally meet Bernadette McGallagher because I thought she was a superb presenter in 1971.
Well, nostalgia for now, with some memories from Eurovision's past. Do you remember these now? One was 1974, when the venue was Brighton, and London hosted the contest in 1977.
Tina Reynolds, in fact, who was sent across to Luxembourg by Ireland last year when they had a little bit of bother about who was going to sing. Well, Tina didn't. And when she came back, she was unfortunately involved in a motoring accident. And this is only her second public performance since. She competed in the Irish National Finals with her song, Cross Your Heart. And now she's come here into Brighton to sing it here on stage for us inside the Dome and try and win the Eurovision Song Contest of 1974.
Stones wouldn't break my bones, though it happened again and again, but I came smiling through, don't ask me how. Playing at games and calling me names never worried me then, but it's a different game we're playing now. Cross your heart, say I love you, cross your heart and I hope to die. For a very simple reason, and here's the reason why.
The Eurovision Song Contest, 1977.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to London. Welcome to the Eurovision Song Contest for 1977. And an especially warm welcome to the very first of those 18 competitors. Ladies and gentlemen, the song from Ireland.
Tina's up there, Tina's up there. It was a wonderful night for you, wasn't it, Tina?
It's like a dream. I think every single singer would love to do the Eurovision. Yeah. Every singer, it's the dream.
But does it start to be all over too quickly, you
it
know?
It is. It's like 3 minutes, but I mean, you think weeks and weeks of rehearsing and going here and photographs, but it's a dream.
Tommy, the Swarbrigs brothers, Al McCardle sitting between them. Tommy Swarbrig, you'd get, in those years, you know, if you won a Eurovision Song Contest, there was 2 years, 3 years working.
Oh, absolutely guaranteed. You were guaranteed to be top of the pops for a good long run. We had great fun out of it.
Yeah, what would they like to work with? Jimmy is beside you over the other end. So you're going to say anthem for himself?
All I can say is that I wish they'd held it in another country. London, like going to London was nothing.
Yeah, you know,
everyone else was going to Yugoslavia.
Great. And, you know. Yeah, that's right. Alma, you were there with them.
Well, I remember looking at the dance there. We used to rehearse the dance up in my house. I had this hall with all these mirrored doors. And I can tell you, by the time we'd finished, Jean Butler would have been proud of these two.
Thank you, Alma.
But you actually, you taught them. You actually did the dance routine. routines with them, didn't you?
Well, we did have a little help at the beginning, and then Nicola and I had the hard work. We had to coordinate them. Yep. Very difficult.
All right, the Twombly brothers, Tina and Al McCarron. When we look at Eurovision with all the glitz of the performers, we can lose sight sometimes of the fact that this is really a contest for songwriters. One of our most successful Eurovision writers has the unique distinction of writing no less than two of the winning songs, as well as winning with a song written by another well-known writer. Let's have a look at two of them.
Is ballad Oignoc Roman Sole what's another year? Cothers few lono blian fame than te a willichri briste. Well, Johnny Logan is anam than a rani a chonan what's another year? Toshe kerabli an a fihadish. Agus bíon sé ag abair a cabaret le na bhanach heol féin, agus ar an radio agus an teilifís. Tá an Commodore Sé Healy ag abair mar ifagach press agus ólais de RTE. Tá bhrí sin tá sé anseo le na árán féin a chorchan cín agus freisin ag súil go mór le go mhuigh sé an dúis. Italy, 10 points.
Et l'Irlande, 12 points.
L'Irlande, 12 points.
We've won. Ireland. I have the words. I don't know what they're saying, you know. Oh, that's absolutely fantastic.
What do you say when words are not enough? What can I say when my words are not enough?
And a fantastic reaction to Johnny Logan there. Hold me now. Well done, Johnny. Man yourself.
Ireland, 12 points.
So there it is, we have it. Johnny has done it again.
Oh, come on, Johnny. Well, that was just, your own song. Just, you hold
just,
me now,
I
wasn't
just
it?
See my wife sitting up in the audience. She meant nothing to me, honestly.
That's great.
Yes, that Hold Me Now was my own song.
Well, yours. Yours is Sean Sherrod, didn't you?
Well, it's always confusing, like, Sean Sheridan, Johnny, as long as it won, I didn't care what I won it with, you know?
Yeah, yeah, because we all remember, any of us, those of us who were around remember, your father was a great singer.
Yes.
Patrick O'Hagan, was it not?
Yes, Patrick O'Hagan, that's
right. Yes, he was serious for us here way back in RTE. What about it, Johnny? It's a huge shop window, Eurovision
Song Contest. It is, like, but what I think a lot of people don't realise is that, if your record isn't in the shop by Monday morning, there's something new comes up in the news and you're yesterday's news. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the way the world is now, I mean, we see the things that happen in the world, like Rwanda and that, and they're put aside by the next piece of information in, and we have the ability to forget about them. I think the same thing, certainly, with the music industry. Mm-hmm. It is very, the realization that you just have that one day, and if you realize that if you win on a Saturday, the records actually have to be pressed on Sunday, which means the record company have to pay double time to the people working in the pressing plants. And there's not that many record companies willing to do it. But it is a huge shop window, and unfortunately, I don't think enough record companies take it seriously enough.
Shay, which would you prefer to be, the singer or the writer?
Well, as long as I don't have to have that tragic haircut again, I don't care. I often thought I would love to have been able to sing properly, you know, but then had I sung,
You're
I wouldn't...
not a bad singer, Shay.
I'm a rubbish singer. My singing is as bad as the haircut.
That's not
I would have written different kinds of songs had I been writing for myself.
Yeah.
But in fact, What's Another Year was quite an exceptional song in that I revealed a lot of myself in it because it was quite personal. It was about my dad and his loneliness after my mother died. So there was a lot of me in that song, whereas when you're writing for other people, you tend to distance yourself a little bit and just write songs for them that have some kind of common emotion in them. You know?
Sure, sure. Any money in it, Shay?
Well, there was, but I mean, it didn't. I was 37 when I won, and it should have completely transformed my life. As it was, it served me all right for a few years, and I got a few years working in the music business.
Sure.
But I think I handled myself badly business-wise, and unfortunately at the time, Sean was unlucky that the people who were looking after him just, for whatever reason, didn't get him to the next level that was needed. So there was no follow-up. But he is the extraordinary story, because he went on and... I mean, you couldn't write, fiction couldn't equal what actually happened with Sean, that he went on and had enough determination to win it as a singer and writer and then as a writer. So he won it in three different ways. It's the most extraordinary story in show business that I have ever come across.
Thank you very much. Can I also say, just before you leave that What's Another Year, the reason that it meant so much to me was that Shay didn't just ask me to sing the song. Shay sat, and he has never been given credit for this, and I'd like to do it now. He sat down with me and he told me how to work to the camera. He also told me what the song was about, and he brought out the performance in me. Nobody has ever done that since. I had to do it for myself in Hold Me Now, and with, you know...
Why did you wait so long to tell me that?
Okay. Sonny Logan and Shay Healy, we should have more time to talk to these fellows. It'll be great crack here later on tonight. The 1990 competition was held in Zagreb. Another Irish singer, songwriter, came very close to bringing home the Eurovision title then. Liam Riley, that was Zagreb, wasn't it?
That's right. It was just on the rumblings of the present sad situation we started to feel the vibrations there.
Did you see? I believe somebody told me you saw the hotel that you stayed in.
That's right. The Hotel Esplanade was probably the only habitable place in the whole city, and a couple of years later I saw it in probably one of the satellite stations, and the news sandbagged and machine gunned and pretty much wrecked. You know, very sad.
Yeah, that's dreadful. You're off to the US, aren't you?
That's right. I spend a lot of time over there. So just this week, the band Bagatelle that I've been with a long time is on the road 36 months this week. So we're going to take a break for 10 days to charge the batteries and do a bit of work out in the East Coast.
Wish you well, Liam.
Thank you very
well.
Much.
These days now, Johnny Logan spends a lot of time outside the country. I believe he's very big in Germany, speaks German, plays in German opera, no less. And we're lucky he can be with us here tonight. So a big bowl of us for Johnny with his own winning song from 1987, Hold Me Now.
Your heart to how you feel. Dream and don't be afraid, the dream's not real. Close your eyes, pretend it's just the two of us again. Make believe this moment's here to stay. Touch and touch me the way you used to do. Oh, I know tonight could be all I'll have with you. From now on, you'll be with someone else instead of me.
So tonight, let's fill this memory for the last time. Hold me now, don't cry, don't say a word, just hold me now, and I will know though we're apart, we'll always be together, forever in love. What do you say when words are not enough? Time, time will be kind once we're apart. And your tears, tears will have no place in your heart. I wish I could say how much I'll miss you when you're gone. How my love for you will go on and on and hold me now. Don't cry, don't say a word, just hold me now and try to understand that I hope at last you found what you've been searching for. And though I won't be there anymore, I will always love you.
Don't cry,
don't say a word, just hold me now, and I will know though we're apart, we'll always be together forever in love. What do you say when words are not enough? What can I say now? My words are not enough.
Thank you.
Walter Rasch eg Lifelines na hiche nocht win comortas auron urafisha. Weis ar shul ihe de sahten shakhoin sa pint depo amalia clear. And if you've just joined us, we're having a little look back at Eurovision Song Contests of years past. Shea Healy and Johnny Logan had won the contest in 1980 with Shea's song What's Another Year. That meant that the contest was back in Dublin for the second time. In 1981, it was held in the RDS.
Agus míle fáilte roib chuig an fiche séú comórtas áráníochta orafise atá chréil anocht ó bhleic lia.
Darren Nivrian, a chos illogery on Eisha Shin. God, you look gorgeous there, Darren. So you did. Stunning, you did.
Weren't they the days?
Because it was a surprise to you at the time, Darren. Were you at all intimidated by it, you know?
Yes, I suppose I would. You couldn't. As Cynthia said, at the last minute, you know, it suddenly dawns on you what you're doing. But I put it right out of my mind because you really couldn't afford to think about what you were doing. You just got out there and did it, really.
Yeah. No teleprompter, of course. No,
I had to learn my words by heart, and it was not easy.
You had some sort of a guard, a trail on your house, hadn't you?
I did. You know, it was the first and maybe the last time in my life that I'll ever be protected by the guard. A plainclothes man came up to me the night before and said, "We'll be keeping an eye on you." And I thought, "What is this grand?" But I thought, what will the neighbours think if there's a guard the car cruising up and down? But I went home anyway that night and had a look and couldn't see him. So I thought, that's great. It's very discreet. Following morning, forgot all about him, drove to the RDS. And just as I arrived, I thought, oh, my God, is he behind me? You know, and I looked and no sign of him. I thought, that's fine. As I walked in the door, this ashen-faced plainclothes guard that came up to me, he said, "You didn't go home last night." And I said, "I did." "You did not?" And I said, "Well, I did. Where did you go?" I said, "To my own house in Rialto." "Rialto?" he said. "I've been sitting outside a house in Sandymount all night." Wrong address. Previous address.
That's lovely. Ian was the director of that. Ian McGarry was the director of that. That was the RDS, Ian. We well remember it.
It was. It was a culmination of many years. Listening to the music tonight brings it all back to me.
Because you were a musician as well.
I met Pat McGeegan in about 1962, and they were playing in the Big Four. I was playing with the Cadets. And through that, I played with the orchestra in the late 60s, and some of the tunes we heard earlier also bring back memories. And then 81 was it. I was put on the spot. So we had to come up with something different from what had happened before. And Tom, who was with us then, was a great mentor, and of course Noel Green, who was also there. Both of them sadly have passed away. And indeed, Paddy Brady, who was also with us, the lighting director, is also gone. But great memories, a great show, a good Irish show, which
because
is what
I
we wanted to do.
I saw the dance there, you know. The dance there had the little look of something familiar to me.
It's funny you mention that, because not a lot of people have spotted that in 81, I asked Bill Whelan to compose some music, which was Time Dance. And we put some dance together with it. So it was, they've modernized it now, and it did phenomenally well, but we had it in 81.
That's a long time ago. Just to say hello and thanks to Marion Fawcett. That's Marion as the ringmaster, she's not ringmistress, I don't know what the word is in the circus.
Ringmistress of Fawcett Circus, that's
and that
right,
was
yeah.
Maxie and...
Francis Campbell,
the trio. Maxie's never been with us tonight. Why isn't Francis here?
Francis is expecting her third baby.
She's into boys on, somebody told me. Okay, thank you all very much. There you are. Fox Fizz won the competition here in 81, so the contest was hosted by England in 82. The venue was Harrogate. The group selected to represent Ireland came from a well-known name in Irish show business. Let's have a look back at the Duskies.
Now to give you all a wave from Harrogate, because Ireland Song is next, and here we go, and hi to all of you. There we are.
Gorgeous, Sandy.
You hear that, Pat says you haven't changed a bit.
Sandy Kelly, Sandy and Barbara. Hello, who were the others in it?
We were known as the poor man's Sheba at the time. Yeah. Nina was the other girl, and Danny, of course, was the...
Danny, he's a cousin of yours, isn't he?
That's right, he's a minister now.
He's a minister, I don't know. Yeah, yes, I met him here one night. What memories have you of us?
One of the memories is Barbara falling out of her shoes on the night.
My shoes were perfect when I rehearsed here, and the minute I got to Harrogate, my feet kept slipping out of the shoes, as Pat and Larry will tell you, and Sandy said to me, "You've lost weight with nerves." So the morning of the Eurovision, we're running around looking for a green pair of satin
shoes.
We stuffed
them with paper, didn't we?
What about the dresses, Sandy?
Well, it was decided on the morning of the Eurovision that we had little jackets originally, that they weren't suitable. So we took off the jackets, and the Eurovision had already started, and we were in the basement having those sequins sewn on the suits. So we had to be sewn into those suits, can you believe that? The Eurovision was half over, and we never seen a bit of it, did we?
No. lovely picture came up there, the shot of Larry Gordon. Oh, yeah. Come on, give him the ball of ours, for God's sake. Larry. It was like you were looking down like an eagle on them, Larry, you know? Like there's a child among you taking notes, you know?
They took a shot of all the commentators that year, you know, the director of the side.
When did
all
you start with radio commentary?
78. In Paris, I did the television for a couple of years and doing radio now for, I don't know, about 12, 78.
It's a great buzz, isn't it?
Yeah. Radio's different than that. You've no pictures, of course, so you have to gather a lot more information and talk from one song, finishes the next song starts, you know?
Yeah.
Just more talking, that's all. More waffling on, you know?
Okay. All right. Now, we're jumping on a few years to 1988 when a group called the Hothouse Flowers came into the international spotlight. When RTE chose them as the interval act for the contest from the RDS in Dublin. But who presented the show? Let's have a look at this one.
Agus foilte roimh illig go bláclia príomh cathar na hÉireann, cathar atá ag ciliúra míle bliain d'aois in 1988. Dar nóid, d'aithin sibh an tÁrán agus an tÁránaí mar tá clú agus cáil Johnny Logan ag dul i méid a gcónaí, agus tá sé fós a mbéilean phobal an bhliain sé caite nuair a bhuaigh sé an comórtas amhránaíochta Eurovision don tar na hóir an céad duine a rinne sin a riamh. Thicken sibh gur scríobh Johnny Logan é féin an tÁrán a chan sé nuairí, Hold Me Now. August is the war on Vuashin at Tomwich, Balaha and Shah, Sakahar Millennium, Don Trocatriu, Comortus, Auraniukta, Eurofisha. Michelle.
Thank you, Pat. Bonsoir. E commandi on Irland, Cade Mila Falce.
I have to tell you that we employed Agatha Christie to write the script for tonight. We have a very close situation. I'm not sure if we can have a quick look at the top five again, but there's 5 points in it, I can tell you, between the United Kingdom and Switzerland. So can Scott Fitzgerald hang on by the skin of his teeth, or will Celine Dion catch up? She's only got to make up five, so it's all to play for. Everything depends on Yugoslavia, and we're going now to Ljubljana to get the final vote this evening. Good evening, Yugoslavia. Good evening, Ljubljana.
Good evening, Dublin. Ljubljana calling. Here are the results of the Yugoslav jury. Norway, 10 points.
Norway, 10 points. Norvège, 10 points.
And finally, France.
A great night.
I could feel the tension looking at that again. Yeah. It was amazing.
Celine Dion, of course, went on to become a big international star.
Yeah.
But at the time, she had no recording contract. There was no record. There was no tape. CDs didn't really exist to any great extent then. They couldn't put the thing on the market. So although she won, it did nothing. It vanished without a trace. As indeed did number two, Scott Fitzgerald. He went back to Amsterdam, whence he came for Britain for the contest, and we never heard of him ever again.
Michelle isn't able to be with us tonight, but that was quite some decision for, I think it was Liam Miller took that decision to put on. She had no broadcasting experience.
I think it was a question of Beauty and the Beast is what they had in mind.
I was about to remark, actually, Mr. Kenny, that, you know, you're not looking bad at all yourself.
Oh, thanks very much, Liam. No, it was terrific.
Would you ever do it again, Pat?
I said no after we had done it, because at that particular time, RTÉ reinvented Eurovision. Every Eurovision since then owes something to that 1988 production. Declan Lowney was the director. They employed a vidiwall, which is passé now, but then it was the first time it had been used. The whole idea of employing light more than physical constructions in sets was new. Ever since then, light has been the dominant feature of all sets. We were the young Europeans, as exemplified by Lima Mainly and the flowers and all the rest of it. We seemed to catch, RTÉ seemed to catch a mood in Europe just at that moment. And that's why I think all the credit that has been heaped upon me and Michelle in our time, a lot of it should go to the backroom people. Michael Grogan, who designed it, and the late Paddy Brady was involved in the lighting and so
cameras,
on.
Sound.
Cameras, sounds. It was just, everything seemed to work in total harmony that particular year.
Some of the crews are here tonight, and I think we should say, even privately amongst ourselves, a big bowl of boss for them. In Luxembourg in 84, an Irish singer was pushed into second place by Sweden. But she got her own back by winning the contest when it was hosted by Sweden in Malmo in 1992.
The winner of the 1992 Eurovision Song Contest is
Well, I
Ireland.
Remember it in The Hague in 1980 when Johnny Logan won with Shea Healy. Now here's Linda. Linda Martin, a lifetime's ambition fulfilled. Came so close with Terminal 3, also written by Johnny Logan. Alan Pentney, the man in Linda's life. And Mary Lowe, and Margaret, and Carol, and Gareth, the backing singers.
It's a great moment for you, was it?
That was marvellous, and I'm just reliving it there, looking at the screen. It's an unbelievable experience. I mean, I could very easily cry just after watching that very short video clip. It's tremendous.
Yeah. And of course, you said you were delighted to win it, not just for yourself, but for Ireland, I believe.
Yeah,
you said
and I
that.
Know it sounds terribly cliched, but in actual fact, you do obviously want to win it for yourself. But you do think about what's back home, and back home are your people, and back home are your family. Mm. And all those thoughts are flashing through your mind. It's tremendous.
Well, what do your people think about? What's your.
Well, my mum's dead nearly 13 years, unfortunately, and I do wish she'd been here to see all this happen to me in my career. But my poor father, God love him, I didn't bring him to Sweden that particular time because I sort of thought, well, it's an awful lot of expense, et cetera, et cetera. And I said, you'd be best staying at home with the rest of the family, which he did. And I finally got to telephone about 2 o'clock that morning, and he couldn't even talk to me. I think that most of the family were sort of comatose at that stage of too much drinking. But, I mean, it was a tremendous experience for him. I mean, he basked in the glory of that because television cameras were at my doorstep at home. And I remember one time he said to me after a particular film clip, he said, you know, I should have had makeup on for that. You know, he was a veteran of the TV screen by that stage.
That's what Dana said to us once that, you know, she said that it was like confessions in her dressing room with the reporters outside coming in. To get to her, you know?
It's unbelievable. Yeah. That particular night after we won, Johnny Logan and myself were in the centre of a ring of photographers. And literally what we did was, to keep security happy and everybody else happy, we literally turned in a circle and let them to have their photographs. And it was like slow motion, but it's unbelievable. Should they get to you, they pull you apart.
Linda Martin. Come on, come on, hand up. Okay, darling. Very good. Why Me, the winning song by Linda in 1992 was written by Johnny Logan under the name of Sean Sherard. Let's listen to Linda sing this again.
Sometimes I watch you passing by my window, and sometimes I watch you passing through my dreams. And sometimes when I look at you, you take my breath away. Sometimes I try and understand your reasons. You choose to feel the way you feel about me. And sometimes when I turn around and you're there like today, I wanna say, why me? I look at you and I get to feeling, why me? I know it's true, but I can't believe it. I keep on wondering why my love shines in your eyes. Why me? I look at you and I ask myself, why me? Sometimes I lie awake and watch you sleeping and listen to the beating of your heart. And sometimes when you're lying there, you take my breath away. And I wanna say, why me? I look at you and I get to feeling, why me? I know it's true, but I can't believe that it's me who's gonna be holding you in my arms tonight. And why it's me who's gonna be the one to make you feel alright tonight. Why me? I look at you and I get to feeling, why me? I know it's true, but I can't believe it. I keep on wondering why my love shines in your eyes. Why me? I look at you and I ask myself, why me?
The Eurovision Song Contest of 1993, and Europe came to Mill Street. Maybe it's not right now on a night of celebration like this to be harping on old bad things, but I personally well remember some of the tabloids at the time saying that what we were going to do was to host the Eurovision Song Contest in a cowshed in a remote town in the south of Ireland. And boy, oh boy, but how wrong they were. What a night of triumph that was.
Bonsoir et bienvenue à vous tous qui regardez RTE ce soir à l'occasion du 38e concours de l'Eurovision.
Luxembourg, 10 points. Luxembourg, 10 points.
And finally, Ireland.
It's fantastic even to relive it, Niamh, isn't it?
Oh, it's still as frightening as it was originally in the
was
first
Was it?
Song.
No.
Yeah. Watching it is very frightening.
But how did a modest little lassie like you, which is a bank clerk or something of that kind, how did you get involved in this wildness?
Well, there's many people who have probably debated about the modest part with you, but... Actually, I've been singing a very long time. Most people think I came out from behind the computer terminal in order that I'd sing, which is probably pretty much what most people thought, but they'd been listening to me for so long with the Commitments and other things that I had done.
Yeah, you were in the Commitments, where you...
Well, I sang on the album, yes. I sang on the album. I sang a couple of songs on that, so that was kind of around a long time, but this was the first time people actually got to see me. Yeah. And I think it was the most said comment since then is basically when on the night you won, it was like the World Cup, because it was the first time we won on home ground, so there was great madness going on. So I've been blamed by many a person for ruining their wedding and stuff like that, because they were all out watching.
There's no doubt about it. I mean, there was nothing equal to the absolute explosion of applause there.
Well, I think a lot of it was to do, obviously, because they were delighted we won on home ground, and of course they weren't a bit biased, But a lot of it was also to do with the fact that Mill Street was such a huge success, and I think that's a major deal.
It was, really. Yeah. Niamh Kaplan. As we remember now, that marvellous Mill Street contest was presented by an RTE newscaster, Finola Sweeney. And she's since moved to greater and bigger things in the United States, where she works for CNN International Television Service. She's based in Atlanta, Georgia, from where she sent us this little message.
Bannock's Tea, or Atlanta, Georgia, are of her fad, the birthplace of the author of Gone with the Wind, Margaret Mitchell. Also, the venue for next year's Summer Olympics and, of course, the home of CNN. I'd love nothing more than to be with you in Dublin this evening. I'm sure you're having a wonderful night. And I'm sure you'll have an even better night in The Point on the 13th. Best of luck to everybody I know behind the scenes who by now must be putting in a lot of long hours. And, of course, a very special hello to my former newsroom colleague, Mary Kennedy. I know you'll do a superb job, Mary. I'll be thinking of you. Slán agus beannacht i gcathanna.
We now link the 93 and 94 song contests with a song by River Dance maestro Bill Whelan. It's called Flying Blind, and here, accompanied by Anthony Cayley, is Niamh Kavanagh to sing it for us.
The softness in the touch of that warm September kiss that I remember most of all, and it set us on a course I could never quite explain, you see, it made no sense at all. We were just like chalk and cheese, as different as could be, but we let foolishness decide. It seemed like worth the ride, for I was flying blind and cut loose. I knew I'd never see the shore. It hardly matters anymore when you're flying blind. You're always on your own. Was the coldness in your voice on that dark December day we said goodbye that I recall? You seemed so silently assured, and as you walked away from me, I found that nothing broke my fall. And as for my regret, knew I'd lost the bet, and you and I would never rhyme. But I'd known it all the time, for I was flying blind and cut loose. I knew I'd never see
So we come to 1995 and the Eurovision Song Contest next Saturday night from The Point. The person who will present that show, somebody else we all know from the news, Rinn Oisle, Cuigí Foitiriv, Mary Kennedy. Were you surprised to be chosen for this?
I was delighted. Really, I suppose it's something I've wanted to do since 1981, when Dhirren, whom you were talking to earlier, was presenting the Eurovision. I was shadowing her for the week in the RDS, and Liam, it was just wonderful. It was like going to Disneyland for the week, and I'm very happy to be making a return visit now. It's great. I'm really looking forward to it. The countdown has begun.
It has, but you now have the advantage, as we said earlier about idiot boards. I refer to myself. You have the advantage of doing it on autocue, but she had to do it off the top of her head.
Or Vas Agam Irti Gudjo in earlier. It was unbelievable. She had it all learned off. I was there with the mouth open. She was wonderful. Mm. I really feel that I learnt the trade well, if you like, looking at her. She was great. Great admiration for her. She was wonderful.
I'm going to chance this anyway. Vous avez un grand avantage. Vous pouvez parler en trois langues, oui?
Bah oui. J'ai passé un an en France après la licence. J'enseignais l'anglais pendant un an. Et après ça, j'enseignais le français et l'irlandais dans une école secondaire ici à Dublin.
So there she's going home.
Liam, you have to take every opportunity to practice.
We all wish you well.
Thank you very much.
It's absolutely wonderful. Up there at the back of the hall is John McHugh and John Comiskey. They're the producer and the director of Saturday Night's show next. We wish you well.
Thank you.
Are you going to bring it back to Ireland to us?
Oh, God. We're going to get through Saturday. We're going to give you a show you're going to enjoy.
Good show. It's a good show. Oh, yes. They beat last year.
We're going to do a different show. We're not up to beat anyone. We're going to do a different show.
We wish
show.
Them all well, the pair of them. Now, the man... that's Liam Miller, who I think I'm right in saying has more experience of this thing than anybody else, in this country at least. You're executive producer twice, William.
I was executive producer in 88 and again in 1993 in Mill Street.
Yeah.
And somebody told me at a fairly lively late-night session one night in Mill Street, somebody from the EBU, that I was the only person whose name appeared on the list of executive producers twice.
I just imagine. But it's an almighty operation, Liam. I mean, people get the impression now that this is a television show. But glory be to God, you're a transport manager. What else are you? You're a finance manager.
I mean, it's moving the army down. But I mean, I think we've seen a lot of wonderful talent here tonight, and that's what it's been all about. And, you know, certainly in the 90s, when I think we really got our act together with the music industry in this country, we've shown what this industry is about. And I think also, and this is really what in particular Mill Street was about, it's what RTE is about. And you were talking earlier about some of my colleagues who are over the other side there. And, I mean, it really is about the hundreds of people who make it happen. And that is everybody from the people who design and build the sets and wire them up and move them all down to Mill Street or the Point or the RDS or wherever. It's the orchestras. It's like everyone you could think of, you know, working out seating plans, working out the hospitality, the VIPs, the delegates. It's an army of people. And, you know, I think you used an expression early on in the show, Liam. It's about doing ourselves proud. And I think the Eurovisions have also been very much about doing the country proud.
Hear, hear. By the way, it's only fitting now that we should wind up this show with a song that will represent Ireland next Saturday night. We send our best wishes and give all our love and good wishes to the writers, Barry Woods and Richard Abbott. And the singer, Eddie Friel. And in this little point now, in this special year of peace in Ireland, it's rather nice, I think, that all three of them are Belfast men. Lifelines tonight, Slán agus Beannacht.
Across my silver sea, goodbye dreaming in the moonlight. Sleepy wake up to reality. Sleepy, wake up to reality.